Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the thank you.
Thank you.
finding myself in a loss for words. And the funny thing is, it's okay. First thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. You pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay. Finding myself in the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise, all that I need is to be with you. Finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay.
Thank you, Jesus.
Praise you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. He's here again. Thanks to the worship team for this wonderful, wonderful time in worship. Good job, Katie, and the team. And a strong presence 2 weeks in a row. you, Lord. Well, welcome, everyone. It's great to see all your smiling faces this morning. You're probably smiling because you know that next week at this time you won't have to put up with me for announcements and prayer. And the Dover Assembly's first family will finally be coming home from vacation to inspire us with God's Word. Special good morning to all the fathers out there. I lost my father about a year and a half ago, and this is my second father today without dad. I hope all of you that are here that still have your father will appreciate him while he's still with us, so that you can hold him dear into your memory when he leaves this earth. Let us pray. Thank you, Father, Father of all fathers, for another opportunity to worship you. We ask you, Lord, that every one of us would be touched by your word this morning, and that through us you would be lifted up and your kingdom would grow. Be with the families everywhere, Lord, as they honor their fathers in this special ways, in their special ways. And please be with Pastor Jeff, Anna, and their family as they travel home to us. Keep them safe, we pray. And Father, we ask that Keith be anointed this morning. Use him as a vessel to fill us with your word. All these things we ask in the name of Jesus. Amen. Let's take a moment to meet and greet each other. All right, let's get started again. Is there anyone here this morning who is visiting us for the first time? Huh? I see a new face back here in the corner. Can the ushers get a packet to that gentleman back there? And we got somebody in the 1, 2, 3, 4, about 5 rows back, right in the middle also. Put your hand up again.
There we go. Did you get a welcome packet back there, sir? Jeremy, can you help us out? We're excited that you guys are here for, that you've chosen to be with us this morning, and if we could ask you to, would you please fill out one of those blue cards in the pew rack? It'll help us with our attendance and to let us know that you were here. And put it in the offering plate. And please, come again. All right, like to go over some announcements. I'm hoping I covered everything that's in the bulletin. Women of Purpose are meeting on the 19th of June. Never mind. Pastor Jeff really needs to get back. We're doing a study on Wednesday nights on the book of Jesus, the book called Jesus Continued. It's why the Holy Spirit in you is better than Jesus beside you. It's an interesting study thus far. We'd love to see each and every one of you there with us. Wednesday nights right here in the sanctuary at 6:30. Our church anniversary for 75 years is coming soon. If you have any pictures from our past 75 years, we'd love to make copies of them. We'll return them to you. Brad gave me a special message to pass on about that. Yeah, pretty much the same thing. We need old photos, old videos for our 75th anniversary. You could see Brad if you have any. We'll make copies. We'll get them all back to you, okay? Also, if you could help us to offset the cost of this event, if you take an envelope from the pew rack, mark it 75, we'll make sure that you get credit for helping. Thank you. New Life for Girls is having a yard sale on the 27th. That's this coming Saturday in our parking lot. It'd be great if some of us could show up and help support their ministry. I don't have times on that, but I'm assuming Saturday morning. VBS. Brad gave me another note. If anybody would like, we do have flyers that the ushers can pass out to help you promote it in your neighborhoods with your families and friends. We're in need of some items for VBS. If you could see Michelle, we need, this is a cool request, fake trees, please. Anybody have fake trees? We need fake trees to create a campground type setting. If you can help out, we could borrow your trees for a while. Please see Michelle. We have actors that are needed for some skits at VBS. They're short skits, small lines, no big deal. We're going to practice once before VBS, but you have to be available for all three VBS days, which are the 20th, 21st, and 22nd of July. I understand the hours are now at 6:30 to 8:30 p.m. those three nights. Ah. Now, all you handy guys out there, we need guys for a prop building team. I guess some of the scenery and so on that needs to be done for VBS, we need some carpenters. That's not me. If you have any special skills in building things like that, please come to us and offer your help. We do need the help so we can promote this to the community. No Wednesday night meals in the next 2 weeks. There have been some scheduling conflicts. Wednesday night meals are out just for the next 2 weeks. Is there anything I've forgotten, anything anyone knows about here that we need cover? Don't all speak at once. All right, will the ushers come forward, please? Father God, thank you for this opportunity to give back to you. You have so richly blessed us. Now is our chance to give back to you, and it feels so good. Please take these gifts and multiply them, Father, so as to spread your gospel. Amen. Thank you.
There's some pretty great dads in this world, and one of them is mine. I know no dad is perfect, but he's pretty darn close a lot of the time. He lets me pop the popcorn when we watch a vid. I'm glad he's my dad.
Whom I love so much. Father whom I love. I love so much. I love you, Dad.
Shut up.
Our Father in heaven, God.
Happy Father's Day, God. Woo!
Today is a special day, and it's bigger than we think, because there are many different kinds of fathers, and they all need to be recognized and honored today. Today, we honor those fathers who consistently strive to balance loving their wives and children with being good, godly workers at their jobs. May you feel the pleasure of God. Today, we honor those dads who had poor fathers themselves, but who have committed never to become the father they grew up under. May your children continue to be guarded from any of the hurt you carry. Today, we honor the fathers who are older and who no longer have day-to-day obligations to their own children. May the family gatherings this weekend make you feel like you could do it all over again. Today, we honor the adult children of fathers who were absent. May the God of the fatherless become your father in ways you've only dreamed of. And may you believe with your whole heart that his leaving wasn't your fault. Today, we honor men who have no children of their own, but who father younger men as mentors and guides. May you see your important roles as impacting and life-changing. And finally, today, we honor fathers who have passed away. May their good deeds live on through you, and may their careless deeds be corrected in your lifetime. Today is a special day. So for all the fathers we mentioned, and even those we didn't, be honored, be blessed, and be joyful. We believe that you have what it takes to change the world. And you're doing it one relationship at a time. Happy Father's Day.
of all the roles that, you know, God can call a man to, the role of fatherhood is certainly one that's special and very much a blessing. If our ushers could come forward at this time, we have a small token we would like to give out to the dads here. So if they may still be here. Okay, great. Thanks, guys. They're right down here in the front in the baskets. If all the dads can just kind of quietly raise your hand, we'd like to just give you a small token from the church to honor you and to say thank you for the work you do as a dad, because it's not easy. All right. Thanks, guys, very much. I appreciate that. Before we get started, I do have a quick prayer request that I would like to make mention of. The Hadarian family, which many of you may be familiar with, Cole and Jamie, their information's on our missionary wall out there. They actually are missionaries in Romania, which is Cole's home country. They've been to our church several times. When they're here on furlough, this is where they attend, and we faithfully try to support their ministry. Jamie's father passed away, the massive heart attack, and so I want to make sure we remember their family. They will be coming back, and I believe spending a year here in the States to be with family and to be here, but just continue to pray for their ministry, pray for them during this time, especially on Father's Day. This is, I think, a double hard blow, so we want to make sure and remember them in prayer. So I'd like to take just a moment and pray with them, if you would, please. Father God, we lift this family up to you, Lord, who faithfully serve you and have followed your leading, God, to share the gospel, Lord, in places where most of us can never go. And they've had this hard time, God. It's a time of sadness and a time of joy at the same time for the homecoming. I know her father knows you and is in a better place, but I also know that it's got to be a very hard loss to take. So, Lord, we pray that you would be with them at this time, God. Share your love, your peace with them, Lord, shower it on them. And we just pray, Father, that you would comfort them during this time and be the peace that passes all understanding, as you promise in your word, Father. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Well, good morning. Very glad to be here this morning. As Mark mentioned, Pastor will be back next week. So he very graciously asked if I could share a few words this morning. So for those of you who may not know this, I'll go ahead and share this, because this can be a continual prayer request or for me and my family. Over the last couple of years, God has really been working in my heart to become more active and to serve him more. It's been a great burden. You know, I have a love for music, so he led me into a place on the worship team. We started there. But I've not felt peaceful, like I'm doing everything yet. And so a couple of months ago, I really took an opportunity to take a good deal of time, do a lot of soul search, and I really just got with God and asked, you know, what do you want me to do? And, you know, you got to be careful sometimes when you ask God that question, because he's faithful and he answers. And he told me, he said, Keith, I want you to preach my message. I want you to go into the ministry. And, of course, I asked a couple of times to make sure I had heard that correctly, because that was not something that had necessarily been on my radar of things to do. But I don't doubt the call. And I've worked with the pastor the last few months, and, you know, we've prayed about it a lot. And so, you know, here I have this opportunity. Now, I am enrolled in some classes, so I am going to seminary, Berean School, which is affiliated with AG, to start working towards my credentials. And I will warn you, I've just started my classes, but I haven't taken the one yet that tells you how to close a sermon out by 12, so I'll do my best. If we run a few minutes long, I ask you to please bear with me, but I think we'll be fine. I've practiced this quite a bit at home, and I think I've kept the time pretty close. So we'll go ahead and get started. Gentlemen, if you can run that first video clip for me, please. Thank you.
stop the car!
So that's the opening scene from a movie called Courageous, which is a wonderful movie. If you've not seen it, I highly encourage you, especially fathers, that you watch that movie. As you can see, it's very powerful, starts off with a punch, and is a challenge to men to do exactly what I've titled the sermon that I've got prepared today, which is, what does it take? In today's society, what does it take to be a godly father, to be a godly man, to be the kind of man that Christ has called to the role of husband and father? Now, ladies, there are going to be things that pertain across the board that we'll talk about today, but this is going to be directed more towards the men. Father's Day, I thought it was a good time to do that. Now, Marlene didn't know this, and I've heard the pastor say this several times about how the Sunday school lesson kind of goes hand in hand sometimes with the sermon. But when she mentioned about children today, and you see the tragic events and you see the things that go on, and you wonder what's happened to our country. And I'll tell you, the answer is really simple, although it's so simple we don't think about it sometimes. We want to look at the broader picture. You have a lot of people out there who say, well, the answer is through government. We need the government to come in and fix things. We need more programs. We need more, you know, whatever the case may be. We have some who say, well, the church hasn't fulfilled its job. We've not witnessed to our nation the way we need to. We've not been as vocal as we need to. We've sat back in the shadows for too long, and we find ourselves where we're at today in our country. Now, as far as government being the answer, I'll leave that up to you. That one's not one that falls into the purview, I don't think, of the church. I will say that I do think there is some merit to what the church has or has not done over the years. But what is the church made up of? The church is made up of people. It's a body of believers that come together. So the problem is not inside the doors, it's outside the doors after we leave. What are we doing as individuals in our own lives? And you see this played out. If you look at the statistics over the last 50 years in particular, at what the devil has done in attacking families in this country. You see loss, you see divorce, you see heartache, all of these things that 100 years ago you just didn't see it as often. Doesn't mean there might not have been problems. Every generation has trouble. But I think this is further proof that we really are living in the last days. This is the end times, whether we want to accept that or not. The signs are rampant. They're everywhere, and they're there. And I think if we want to try to reclaim our country for Christ and make a strong stand in those last days as a remnant of God's people, it has to start with the individual. And the individual into the family into the church into the world. It has to start here. It starts at home. You know the old saying, charity begins at home. Charity is an old King James word for love. Now in the clip you just saw, if you look in the book of John, in chapter 15, verse 13, it says, greater love has no one than this, that he laid down his life for his friends. Now, if friends is greater, it implies greater than what? What is laying down your life for friends greater than? Well, it implies that it's greater than your love for family. So the love for family, through this verse, it's implied that of course you're going to do that for your family, or you should. Because the greater love is to do it for people you don't even know, you have no ownership, no interest, no vestment in, with your friends, like you do with your family, with your own family. And we see this played out in Scripture. If you look in Ephesians, in chapter 5, and verse 25, husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Now, this is a special role that was given to men. Ladies, there are parts in the Bible that talk specifically about your role as well. But men, this one talks to us. And I think in order, if we're going to say it takes a family into the church, into the world, to change this world and to really proclaim the gospel, we can't just say, well, I'm going to be a better father. Because if we're not being a good husband, how are we then going to give that example to our kids and be a good father? It starts at the beginning, and we're going to see that in just a moment. As far as with children, if you look in the book of Matthew, in chapter 7, in verse 11, that's the one that talks about Jesus saying with gifts, right? If you, though you're evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask him? So he's saying, you know, in our humanness, you even know how to be good to your own kids. How much greater is God to us? And then one that you don't have in the back, gentlemen, I'm sorry, I'm throwing some extra ones in. This morning, again, do Sunday school. In Psalm 103, in verse 13, as a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him, for he knows how we're formed. He remembers that we're dust. You know, God sees us in our humanness. He knows we can't do this on our own. But it talks about how we have compassion on our children. Now, the clip that we showed, that we started off with, now this deals with the physical, right? The guy's physically trying to do something. And as men, that's the expectation of how we're supposed to be. When God made men and women in the beginning, he hardwired certain things into us that's just inherent in our nature. For guys, it's being physical. You know, we're supposed to be tough. We're supposed to be hardworking. To a certain extent, we're supposed to be devoid of emotion, which that one I don't always succeed at, but you know, we're supposed to try and hide a lot of that and internalize. There's a natural drive to be in charge. You know, that's my remote, don't touch it, right? You know, does anybody else have that argument at the house? You know, so we're supposed to be there. And then we have that inherent drive that says we give till it hurts. And at the point of pain when it hurts, we give twice as hard. We just do. You don't stop. Because if you're not, you don't do it. You're not a man, right? If you're doing it right, though, it's because it's going to be out of love. There's a lot of reasons why we can be stubborn, but love has to be the driving force behind it. If you look in the book of 1 Timothy, in chapter 5 and verse 8, which I've also not taken the class on Mark in your Bible ahead of time, so bear with me. That one's coming. But in 1 Timothy chapter 5:8, it says, if anyone does not provide for his relatives, and especially for his immediate family, he has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. Ouch. You know, that's pretty tough, right, guys? We've got to provide. So we have this inherent desire to do this, the notion of responsibility. Now, despite what science will tell you through the theory of evolution, that people have changed and evolved from all kinds of things, and that over time stuff is no longer the same, newsflash, it doesn't change. The basic drives and desires of mankind have not changed since the beginning. We've not evolved, the toys change, okay? Now it may be, you know, that we want to own a fancy SUV or a powerboat. You know, 300 years ago, it may have been the best horse. A few hundred years before that, it may have been a nice suit of armor or the nicest boots. You know, there's always toys that are going to change. But that same drive that's inside of us, it hasn't changed. And the responsibility to provide for a family out of love and to do that was instituted in the beginning. If you go back and you look at the biblical account starting in Genesis chapter 2, it talks about where God creates man and woman. He creates man out of the dust of the earth, breathes in him, man becomes a living soul. And then he gives man his first job. He puts him in the garden. And he says, here, you tend the garden. He gives him a job to do, and he tells him something not to do. He says, don't touch these trees over here, right? Knowledge of good and evil. Tend the garden. Well, that's a lot of responsibility. God goes on to say, you know, he needs a helper. And then Adam goes out, and you see him naming all the animals and going through everything, doing the job that God called him to do. And then after he's done that, and you get the impression from reading Scripture that Adam's actually going out, again, physically going out to the different animals. They didn't come in a big line to him, because it says everywhere he looked, he didn't find a suitable helper for him. Then that's the point where God causes Adam to fall into the sleep, removes the rib, and creates woman. One of woman's first jobs assigned by God was to help. Was to help what? Was to help the man do the work he was called to do. And this is the institution of family. Man and woman joined together. So there it is from the beginning. Those same drives, though, that God placed in Adam and Eve, you'll still see it today. Adam was what? He was in charge. As guys, we naturally want to take charge of things. That's what we do. In the marriage situation, when you have men who are focused, they're dedicated, particularly godly men who spend their time in prayer, if their wives are also godly and they're equally yoked, what you'll find is that she's very supportive, she's very helpful, right? You see these things working hand in hand as the way God intended it to be. And unfortunately, to finish out the creation story, what you've noticed in the garden is that they didn't follow the instructions. They didn't listen to God. And so they got cast out of Eden, and it was messed up. What do we see in our world and in our nation today? We've turned from God as a nation, and the nation's messed up. Again, nothing changes over the span of time. You don't see any difference. And there's a reason for that, because God doesn't change. If God doesn't change, his creation, which he made, is not going to change. At least not without him. Now, interesting question. I want to ask you this, because this was something God showed me as I was preparing for this. And I had never thought about it this way before, but this is food for thought. Who sinned first? Was it Adam or was it Eve? Okay. I see a couple of different answers. And I'm going to explain this to you, and I want you to take a look at this with me, because this is interesting. This, if you want to go back and read this, this is in Genesis 2 and 3. Adam was put in charge and was told, don't do certain things. Don't eat this tree. Eve, as you read through the scripture, you understand that Eve was also given this instruction, because when the serpent's tempting her, right, he says, well, you know, surely he said not to, and he says, no, no, God said don't eat of that tree. Don't do that. That's wrong. But the thing that's interesting is a lot of depictions that you see of the garden scene. It shows Eve by herself, standing in front of the tree with the serpent hanging out, tempting her. Now, you can look at artwork from hundreds of years ago, and that's generally the kind of depiction that you get. The problem of it is that's not scriptural. If you go back and you actually read the account of what happened, Adam was with her when this whole thing happened. And if you read the dialogue, you get the impression that the flow is that it was all real time. The serpent's tempting her. It says that Eve touched the fruit. She partook of the fruit and gave it to Adam, who did then take of it. So he was there. She picks the fruit, boom, takes it, hands it over to him. I would make the argument, though, that the problem came in the fact that he was in charge. He's supposed to love his wife. He heard the sales pitch, and he didn't do anything. Ouch. You know, guys, that responsibility thing is a double-edged sword. And I'll tell you, if you ever get in prayer about this and really say, God, as a husband, as a father, what is it that I'm really responsible for? If it doesn't get you down on your knees, I don't know what will. Because you begin to understand, I'm the spiritual head of my household. What did Joshua say? Choose you this day whom you will serve, but as for me and my house, we'll serve the Lord. He's not consulting his wife. He's not asking, honey, if it's okay with you. He's not asking his kids, well, do you feel like going today? No, he says, I'm in charge. God gave me this authority. This is what my house does. And he instituted that godly authority. And that can be difficult, I mean, especially in today's world. Now, my kids are young. It's a little easier to maintain, you know, here's what we're doing, guys. Here's what we're, you know. I've been a teenager. I remember I didn't always want to do what Mom and Dad wanted to do, and I didn't often, you know. That's part of what we do as teenagers. We have that rebellious streak that comes out. So I pray hard for my kids. And that's the question that I want to raise. The physical part of being a guy is difficult because we will push, we will do whatever it takes to get the job done. That's inherent. 60 hours a week, mandatory overtime, fine. We're going to do it. We're not going to like it, but we're going to do it. Right? Absolutely. We're wired up that way. But I'm going to submit to you that that is actually the easiest part of anything that God has called you to do. The hard stuff is all the spiritual things. Because again, as men, we're hardwired with certain things. And that physical drive, that's our natural instinct. And it's funny, my own daughter, my oldest girl, she calls me, you know, King of Stubborn at home. She has something she can't open. She says, I need the King of Stubborn, because she knows I'm going to do whatever it takes to get that done. I mean, my kids see that, right? And that can be a good thing if they see it in the right context. They also see me back down when I need to and admit when I'm wrong. Grudgingly, but I do it. But the things that God has called us to do, if you think about the things in the Bible that God says, this is what's important, this is what's going to last, it's the spiritual things. I mean, out of all the things you can do for your family, with your kids, sharing time in God's Word with them is going to be the one thing you will never regret doing. I have prayed since 9 months before my first daughter was born, and it's pretty much a daily prayer that my kids would come to know Jesus at a young age, they would stay true to His Word all their life. I'm very thankful to say that my first girl, who just turned 7, got saved when she was 6. And when we pray as a family at night, I say it out loud so my kids can hear it. I say, God, I thank you for Cora's salvation, and I'm praising you, Lord, for Eric's and Daisy's. I pray for theirs so that they hear it, that they understand it, that they know, hey, Cora has something. What's this about? And as they get older, they can start asking questions, because that's going to be what gets them through in life. That's what's going to be what provides for them. Guys, here's a newsflash. It's not us. It's God Almighty. And we have to instill in our kids now the important things. You know, the hard work ethic, all of that kind of stuff, that's all found in here. It's not a bad thing. God wants us to have that work ethic. He wants us to have that drive. But He also wants to make sure it's in the right order and it's in the proper perspective, that He's first and that we show that example to our kids. And that's difficult. As a man, I will tell you that is very difficult to do, and my wife can tell you how hard I've struggled with that over the years, of saying, I've got a job to do, and I'm going to have to walk away from that to go and do a family obligation that in the long run is really spiritually a lot more important. Because as guys, we want to work. We want to get things done. We don't want to leave things hanging. But we have to understand that there comes a time where we've got to turn things off and say, no, this is what's more important, God's Word. You know, between husbands and wives, again, it's a team effort with the kids, right? Guys, if you want your wives to be the kind of wives that God wants them to be, you got to first be the kind of man God wants you to be. It's just the way that it works. And I can tell you a personal example with Lynette and I. We are both very headstrong, stubborn people. I know that may come as a surprise to most of you. Yeah. But we are. And when we first got married, it was like cats and dogs for the longest time. And the best description that I could come up with is I pictured a team of horses pulling a big heavy load. And if you know anything about farms and animals and stuff, you know, when you've got animals, you want to have one that's up front that takes the point and the other one that takes their lead from that one so that they pull together and work as a team. And we didn't do that. We both wanted to pull our own directions and fuss and fight and do whatever. And we came to a point where we were having a really intense conversation. And, you know, she said, well, you just won't lead. And I remember I said, well, I can't lead because whenever I try, you never listen anyway. And I'm sure nobody's ever said that in here before, right? Yeah, right? So, but the thing that was interesting with it is we both, once we had our fuss and kind of had our time, we came back together and we prayed about it. Because we both realized that we were both right. She will tell you that she did not want to submit, she did not want to listen, she did not want to follow. And I'll tell you why, is because I was doing, frankly, a lousy job of leading. I was giving her absolutely nothing to follow. I was being very passive with a lot of stuff. And faithful wife. If you go back and you read in the scripture, and I don't have the verse handy in front of me, but you remember it talks about how the woman's not going to win her husband over with lots of words. It's going to be through her example in the house. Exactly what happened with us. Lynette got serious about it. She said, okay, fine, I'm going to submit, I'm going to do. And I started seeing this example. God was dealing with my heart, and I said, no, I got to step this up. And this is when God started laying this on my heart about this responsibility thing. I got to take it serious, and I got to do it. Now, we didn't have kids at this point, which made it a little easier. But I did. I took up the challenge, and I stepped up. And now, you know, do we always work everything perfect? No. You're always going to have times when you disagree with things. But now we have our focus in the right place. We put this book as the central piece of our family. And so when we have issues that go on, this is where we go. Now, I mentioned that I prayed for my kids, pray for my wife. The idea of the intercessor, that's where we have to start, because it all starts with prayer. Prayer is basically what? Spending time with God, right? You're talking to God. You want to spend time with God. You want to find out what God wants for you. That's where we got to start. How to fix your family, how to fix your nation, how to fix your church. It starts with time with God. In the book of 1 Timothy, if you look in chapter 2, verse 1, Paul's writing to Timothy, says, I urge then, first of all, that requests, prayers, intercession, and thanksgiving be made for who? For everyone. Wow. Okay, so you ever wondered who to pray for? What should I pray for? There's your answer. You pray for everyone. That makes it pretty easy. And then he goes on to describe this. In verse 3, it says, this is good and pleases God our Savior. Why? Who wants all men to be saved and come to a knowledge of the truth. Now you know why you need to be praying. Okay? Your kids don't know Jesus, we got to get in prayer. Your family doesn't know Jesus, we get in prayer. This is where it starts. In verse 8, same chapter, I want men everywhere to do what? Lift up holy hands in prayer without anger, without disputing. And then in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 17, we ask the question of, well, okay, I'll try to pray as much as I can, but how often is enough? We pray without ceasing. Pray continually. It's a never-ending thing. God calls us to do it. And why? If you look in the book of James, chapter 5, it tells you in verse 16, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so you may be healed. Why? The prayer of a righteous man is powerful and effective. So it starts with prayer. And I see we are getting a little close on time, so I will try to keep this very short. But I have one other video clip that I want to show you that I think demonstrates the role of the intercessor in a prayer life, particularly between a father and a son, as this is Father's Day. I got to give you a quick background on this. It's from a movie called Facing the Giants, which, again, if you've never seen it, I highly recommend that you watch it. It's a fantastic movie. But it's about a high school football coach who is at the end of his rope. He has a losing team. He and his wife are trying to have children. He finds out that they can't, and it's his fault that they can't. So he's got that extra burden on top of him. He's about to be fired, and the people that he thought were his friends are basically stabbing him in the back and trying to take his job. So he's got a lot of pressure on him, and he gets down with God, with time, and he just asks, he says, God, what do you need me to do? I can't live my life this way. What can I do? And God reveals a plan to him of basically ministering through the football program, help turn the kids' lives around, be that mentor, and to give it all to God, to do everything they do for God's glory. Now, through this part of the story, we get to meet some of the players. There's a young man named David. Now, David is a sophomore. He is new to the area. He just transferred into the school. The school district he was in before, he had played soccer. So he's never played football in his life, but he loves sports. He wants to play. And so they bring him in as a walk-on kicker. Now, for those of you who aren't familiar with football, we will pray with you after the service. But a walk-on kicker is basically your backup, right? He's the guy that you're training. You let him play some when you're ahead 60 to nothing. You'll send him out to do a couple of plays because if he messes up, not such a big deal. But you also train him up because if your primary kicker gets injured, you got to have somebody to put in, right? So he's your auxiliary, your backup person. So David is kicking. Now, David's a small guy. He's about 5 foot nothing, about 140 pounds. So if you know football, you know that's not exactly easy for a kicker anyway, because you got to have some height and some strength behind you to get that ball down the field. But he's played soccer, so his leg muscles are pretty well developed, and they bring him in, start practicing and working with him, and he's, you know, pretty awful starting out at first. It's hard to kick a football. His dad is an older gentleman. You get the impression that his mom has passed away at some point, so it's just him and his dad. His dad is an invalid, can't walk, he's in a wheelchair, but he's very supportive of his son, attends every game, never misses one. And he always, on the sidelines, he's down next to where the players are at, and anytime David is called out to make a kick, his dad raises his arms before he even kicks the ball, like this. Which, if you know football, that means that you've made the field goal. You've gotten either the extra points, you've gotten the 3 points, but the ball went where it was supposed to go. He was demonstrating faith for his son. Remember, what's faith? Hebrews 11:1. Evidence of things hoped for, substance of things, right? Not evidence, substance of things hoped for, evidence of things not seen. There we go. But he was doing that for his son. As a father, that's part of that intercessory role that we have. We have faith in our kids. We encourage our kids. Even when they don't believe they can do this, we do this. So where they're at in the game, in the movie, this is towards the end. They're actually at the national championship game. And gentlemen, if you can go ahead and just roll that for me quickly.
You gotta kick it, man.
David!
I need a 51-yard field goal.
Coach, I can't kick that far.
David, they've been stopping the run of the pass all night. You're my best option.
Coach, the farthest I've ever kicked is a 39-yarder. There's no way I can kick a 51-yard field goal.
I believe you can. Your job is to do the best you can and leave the results up to God. I need you on that field.
Our field goal unit!
Grant, we've gotta throw it. He can't kick it from there. It's too far.
No, it's not.
What are you doing?
Preparing for rain.
I don't understand this, but with 2 seconds left on the clock, Coach Grant Taylor and the Shiloh Eagles are putting the game in the hands of a 145-pound backup kicker.
This is not a good move on Grant Taylor's part. He even has to kick into the wind.
David! David!
He's not ready, Grady. Don't think he can do it.
I don't have any more timeouts. Call a timeout, Bobby Lee.
This kid can't kick that far.
Call a timeout.
Call a timeout anyway, and we'll fight him.
Hey, come here.
David, are you telling yourself you're going to miss this kick?
Coach, it's too far.
Listen to me. Do you think God could help you make this kick? Do you believe it, David?
Yeah, if he wants to.
So do I. But you have got to give me your best and leave the rest up to him. Will you do that for me? David, whether you make this field goal or not, we're going to praise him. But don't you walk off this field having done any less than your best.
Can I help you?
Don't touch me. I'm standing for my son.
Help me make this kick.
Kick it now! Kick it now!
Kick is up, it's on its way. It's long enough, it's high enough. Does it have the distance? It's good! It's good! The Eagles have won! The Eagles have won!
Thank you, God!
I can't believe what I just seen!
Now there's the difference that a father praying for his son can have. I have a hard time watching that scene without getting a little teary-eyed. It means a lot to me because when I see that clip, I've been very blessed. I see the relationship that me and my dad have. My dad has always supported me. He's always been there for me. He's believed in me when I quit believing in myself at times. And he's always been there for me. And I know he's going to be watching this later, so, you know, Dad, thank you. And I love you. Happy Father's Day. And, you know, guys, that's our challenge. Now, what they did was for the movie, because it was dealing with football, they didn't realize they were being scriptural at the same time. You remember 1 Timothy 2:8, men pray everywhere doing what? Lifting holy hands. He's down there praying for his son with lifted hands. And it means that the job got done. It's giving thanks to God. So my challenge I want to leave you with this morning is, guys, you want to see a difference in your family? You want to see a difference in the world around you? Take the time and make the time to pray. If you already do it, ask yourself, am I doing it enough? I won't have time to go into it right now, but there's actually a thing you can do if you want to mathematically look at it. You can take the amount of hours that you have in a week and start breaking it down. I spend this much at work, I spend this much sleeping, I spend this much. And I think what you'll be surprised to find is that you have a lot more time than you realize. Maybe it's just that we're not managing as well as we need to. But the day is late, and the hour is short. No man knows when the Father cometh. We don't have any more time to waste with this. We've got to get serious with it. So that's my challenge for myself and for all of us, to step up to the plate, to make that commitment to God, to make that commitment to your family, to get serious for God and do the job that God gave you to do. Let's go ahead and close in a word of prayer. Father God, I thank you, Lord, for revealing in your word, God, what you want us to do. I pray, God, that as we leave here today, we would seek you and ask you, God, what it is you want of us. Because you've created all of us with a purpose, Father. And we know that we can do whatever you call us to do because you'll equip us, God. You'll give us that. We'll step out in faith. You will give us what we need when we need it. We also know, God, that that first step comes with a relationship with you. So my first prayer is if you've heard me speak this morning and you've been listening to this and you think, well, you know, this commitment to God, that sounds wonderful. Where do I start? The place we start is with a relationship with Jesus Christ. If you've never accepted him as your personal Lord and Savior, if you've never made that commitment, that's your first step. With every head bowed and every eye closed, I would just ask that if you've not made that decision, just to quietly slip up your hand. I'm not going to embarrass you. I'm not going to call you out. But after the service, I would love to take the opportunity to introduce you to the best friend you're ever going to have. Okay, I'm going to assume that all of us here then are believers. Praise God. If you're willing to make that commitment and say, you know, I want you to pray for me. I do want to step it up. There's more I can do. I just ask that you would, again, with every head bowed, every eye closed, just quietly lift your hand. My hand is up. I see those hands. Praise God. Praise God. Father, you see our hearts. You see the dedication. You see the needs, Lord. I ask, God, that you would give us your measure of grace, Father, so that we can be the kind of people you need us to be to help win a lost and dying world. God, let it start with our families. Let us be the husbands and the fathers that you've called us to be, God, first, so that we can be an effective witness to those around us, God. Help us to be that example for our kids, Lord, so that we can lead them to a saving knowledge of you. Help us to be that high priest of our household, God. Let our kids see a love in us for you that goes beyond all understanding, Father. Teach us, Father, how to put you first and make you first. And help us to listen, Lord, so that we can hear your word at all times. I ask, God, that you would please go with us from this place today. Thank you for the day that you've blessed us with, and I pray, God, that you would bless the family time for everybody that'll be celebrating today, Lord, to keep us safe, bring us back safely together in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you all very much. I hope you have a wonderful, happy Father's Day. God bless, and we'll see you back hopefully Wednesday night.